Tēnā mātā waka. Tēnā koutou, nā mihi mahana ki a koutou. Ko wakato te waka, ko tainui te waka, ko wakato te iwi, ko Ngāti Tahinga te hapū. Ko Whaingaroa te moana, ko Kareoe te maunga. Ko Weraroa te marae, ko Ngāti Tahinga te hapū. Ko Huhana hau. Nō reira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa. Kia ora koutou, everybody. Doctor Who, the real deal, not the fake one on TV. And Doctor Who's a woman. Exactly. I needed to clarify that, okay? Doctor Who is a woman. Thank you very much for that lovely introduction. It makes you feel like you've done a lot, but you've really done nothing. But there's still more to do. I actually got Huhā in 2000. I went to Washington DC as one of two New Zealanders around deciding whether we're to have a convention on the rights of persons with disabilities. I had finished my master's and was about to do a PhD, but what made me Huhā is that the Indigenous committee had been fighting in the end 16 years before they got their declaration of Indigenous people's rights. It took 5 years for the UNCRPD to develop. It was so fast they excluded Indigenous peoples from the articles.
Could you clarify that acronym?
Oh yes, the UNCRPD, the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. We love acronyms, they're just so much easier. I'm lazy. But what happened out of that is, why did it take 16 years to get a declaration in place, which is a lot less in strength than a convention, which took 5 years to get in place? And why were Indigenous peoples excluded? Now, I argued, I fought, I even got vilified by the very famous Helen Clark, because I challenged her at a convention, and a Labor Party one, and I really wasn't welcome back after that. Part of it was that she wouldn't let the sign language interpreters stand next to her, so the deaf couldn't see what the interpreting was, and she wasn't even comfortable around disability. But it showed a bigger picture, what was going on. And the thing that was going on is that when they developed the working party, they had a Māori on the team, but the Māori was told, do not argue for Indigenous people's rights. You're there to argue on disability, as though we can compartmentalise our identities. And I fought again for that, couldn't get there. I was even threatened by the Office for Disabilities Issues that if I went to the United Nations, they would discredit me. So I did the right thing. I went behind their back. And this is what happens when you don't have fear of repercussions. Well, I went beyond fear. I got blacklisted, probably will never get a job in government, and I'm quite comfy with that. I don't want to. But what happened was I got to Spain and was able to argue to get us into the preamble, which is the set of statements at the very beginning. And I've left you all some copies of UNDRIP there. The same thing with the convention is that the preamble says a set of I guess, aspirational statements would be more clear facts. So they recognise the extra marginalisation and discrimination of Indigenous peoples, elderly, other minority groups. But they wouldn't include us in with women and children and other thematic groups within the convention. So we were excluded. So what happened out of that? I got an apology from the UN 2 years later that they rushed it. They rushed it because New Zealand was actually, they won the Human Rights Award for the convention and received a monetary amount which went to Disabled Persons Assembly and CCS Disability Action. Now, they won the award, but they haven't done much about it ever since. Now, the declaration is another problem because Indigenous weren't included in the convention, but as a Māori Indigenous disabled woman, I couldn't get into the UNDRIP discussions. Luckily, the internet exists, and I was able to stir up all the other Indigenous that I'd set up this group for, and we were able to argue and got two articles into the declaration. Articles 21 and 22, which recognises the rights of Indigenous peoples. Now the point I'm saying all that is not to have sympathy because I'm blacklisted by the government, I really don't care about them. Honestly, I'm their employee, they're not mine. And so I like to remind the MPs that I pay for their wages. But the point is that you have to pursue for your rights. You must pursue for your rights. Now that goes right back to Te Tiriti o Waitangi. That is a human rights document in my book, and that's how I teach it. And the reason I teach it is that there was 600 years of international law went behind that document. The Indigenous version is the version that international law says must be applied, interpreted and followed. Not the white man's version, not the Pākehā version, not the European version, but the Māori, the Indigenous version, is the version that takes priority. But not only that, it guaranteed us equity. Every citizen was guaranteed equity. We were told as Māori, we would have the same rights as those British that came in. We were told a whole bunch of things. At the time that all happened, there was something else going on. The missionaries were colonising. They were also bringing in the Bible when they were implementing medical help. As a result, they implemented the Old Testament and taught quite a narrow version, which led to some misinterpretations, some literal interpretations, things like Deuteronomy 21, saying that disabled carry the many sins of our ancestors, which we never had a concept of that prior to colonisation. We also didn't have a label around disability. So for Māori, we don't identify as disabled. I certainly don't. I do for political purposes, but I don't in my own world. Who am I? I'm whānau first and foremost. I'm actually a member of a whānau. I'm a member of a iwi, of a hapū, of a whānau, and as an individual. Therefore, as an Indigenous person, not only do I have individual rights set out by the UN or the Human Rights Commission, by the UN Convention, by UNDRIP, by the United Nations, but I also have collective rights. And that is what we are failing to understand. Ehu Mātou, I hope I pronounced that correctly, is one example of where you could access the rights by utilising the international instruments and arguing for those rights, because we're about to lose our stone fields, the oldest gardens in Aotearoa, oldest example of Indigenous gardening practices in New Zealand. We're about to lose that to a bunch of buildings. Why would we give that up for the sake of humans? Why do we give up our history? One of the things I learned, when I started out advocating, I was an angry person. I started with my son born with disabilities and I had to advocate for him. I learned over time that anger got you nowhere and got you labelled and got a reputation. And when I meet people that knew me 20 years ago, they go, oh, you've mellowed. I haven't. I've just learned to be a little bit more effective in how you argue a point. And the best way to do that is know the law. Know your rights and know the instruments you can use. So we don't get many human rights cases to the Human Rights Review Tribunal. We're mostly getting privacy cases. Why? Well, one, they're trying to save money, but also they're not bringing them further through. People aren't insisting. They're settling at mediation, but they're not always settling. They give up. The thing is that we don't charge if it's a genuine case. So whilst it might seem expensive, even if you lose, we're not going to charge you if you're an average citizen who's trying to take a genuine case of rights. The problem is a lot of people don't know what's available out there. And so it's really important that you start to realise that it's only useless if you don't use it. The UN is only toothless if you don't exercise the instruments and use your rights. So, you know, I'm not going to go into detail because we've got really short time, but one of the points is that as Indigenous peoples, we have an obligation and a duty. I have an obligation and a duty to my muku who's here tonight to teach her that she is not some useless young girl who's Māori and going to fall by the wayside under drugs and no education, have a dozen children. By the time you're 16, you better not, girl. She's not going to do that. She's going to look for the best that she can be, because we believe in her in doing that. But we're not teaching our people that. We're not teaching our people that they are full of value. 33% of Māori have a disability in this country. Under the age of 25, did you know that we have 46% of those under the age of 25 have a disability who are Māori? Our youth, they're our future leaders. Who are our iwi leaders with disabilities in this country? None. Who are our hapū leaders with disabilities in this country? Very few. The other thing, though, is that in exercising those, we need to be sure that we pull out every one of those and we uffy each other. We pull each other down. And I think Mātua, if you're still here tonight, he spoke of love, unconditional love. We have one of the highest crisis rates in this country, and it's mostly Māori. Did you know at the age of 40, 67% of Māori have a disability? 67%! We're dying on an average much earlier than everyone else. The only way we're going to turn this around, whānau, is if we turn our backs on Western medicine, we turn our backs on Western ideology, and we reclaim Indigenous knowledge, Indigenous rights, and Indigenous values. And the only way we're going to do that is if we talk together about that. And we do it together. Remember the foreshore and seabed? Over 20,000 went. Over 20,000. That took notice in our country. We can do it again. We've got to stop dividing each other and work together. And if we want to succeed with this, we utilise it, use it, know it well. They hate me in government because I use that as the instrument when I'm arguing for rights for a particular group. And I will leave you with one little example of why it's so important. Earlier this year, there was a meeting in Geneva of Indigenous disabled. Did you know that no New Zealand Māori went? I asked Marama Fox, the Associate Minister for Disabilities, to talk to Nikki... Sorry, I struggle with the last name. It's Wagner. I have this default position of calling her Nikki Wanker. But Nikki Wagner, I know, I don't care. No, she burnt her bridges on this one. When I asked Marama what was going on and why no Māori was attending, she went to Nikki. Nikki's response was, I'm sure you won't be surprised, I'm not wasting my resources on that. Now, Pākehā are going to the disability huis, right? Where's the Māori voice? Do you know, I had Moana Jackson ring me up from one hui in the UN in New York one time, myself and Tanya Kingi, saying, oh, Kari, they've got a disability forum on here and we need to have our voice in there. What do I say? Well, why aren't the hauā going alongside the non-disabled Indigenous peoples and representing? Our voice is silent, and yet we make up one third in our young years, and we are two thirds as we get older, and two thirds, well, half, when we are young. So why are we not there? Why are we not present? We need to start demanding this, whānau. We need to start demanding that the iwi reflect the kaupapa, that all marae should be accessible, that service dogs should be welcome on all marae, that it should be tactile for our kapu. It should have, we should have more than two New Zealand trilingual sign interpreters. We've got 13,500 Māori deaf. Two trilingual sign interpreters. And they're women. Imagine what it's like on a marae for a deaf person, or when you're having to do the pōwhiri or the mihi whakatau, and you've got a woman speaking with a man who's deaf because there's no male trilingual sign interpreter. It's breaching cultural protocols. It's breaching Te Tiriti o Waitangi. It breaches UNDRIP. It breaches the UNCRPD. And it's time we said no more. They walk over us because we let them. Amen. We need to stop that, whānau. And I'll leave that and put you on to Heather, who's my go-to around institutionalised racism. Kia ora. Kia ora.
It's an experience to share an office and a workplace with Huhana. Kia ora tātou, I'm Heather. My goddaughter is Ngāpui. My niece and nephew are Ngāti Whātua and Ngāti Maniapoto. My new grandchildren are Ngāti Kahanunu. I'm a seventh generation Pākehā New Zealander, and that is the story of, that's a story of transformation and love. Thank you, Matua, for talking about crocheting, knitting, needlepoint. I wasn't quite sure what discipline it was, but I'm all about the drop stitches. My mahi has become about how the government discriminates against Māori in their administration of the public sector. And every direction we look in the health sector, we see the institutional racism, whether it be in how the policy is made, how they purchase health services, the delivery of health services, how they look after the workers in the health system, etc. So we're going to Geneva. And we're going to tell some of the stories of the racism in this country, and it's kind of exciting, but it's kind of bad because we've already written 7,000 words and we were only supposed to write 2 pages. Oops. But we've written lots of beautiful recommendations about solutions, and that's been great fun. And someone else is writing the executive summary, and that will be a page. So aroha mai to our mates Grant and Teresa that are doing that mahi. But I think about treaty work as peace work. And I think about our mates in Parihaka this week. And I think that when we honour te tiriti and when we end institutional racism and that structural violence, I think then we'll have rangi Māori. And that's my dream and my hope for the mokopuna, the niece, the nephew, the goddaughter, the gang. And I think that if we embraced tikanga and we did what was tika, there would not be institutional racism. We wouldn't need all of these human rights frameworks to, as wedges and leverage to fight back. So I'm part of the resistance with STIR, Stop Institutional Racism. So kia ora to our crew that are here. And we're part of a whole mob of different folk who in different ways are resisting institutional racism and trying to clear the way so Indigenous people can enact their rights any way they choose. So know that, particularly I think of my crew and tamaki treaty workers. I have the privilege of working with people that have been doing this mahi for decades. So know that you're not alone, and we're in there till the end. And we will try and be good allies and try and walk alongside you, and we'll write down a lot of words. And then we'll try and distill it to less words. But really, what we're saying is that you're really, really wrong. So I'm sure that's our time. Who, have you got a final word?
Just remember, if we empower people, they never go back down that road of being abused anymore. I refuse to accept myself as a victim of colonisation. I refuse to accept myself as dying as a result of colonisation. I choose to live and live with my truth. And the thing is, the only way we can do that is we've got too many of our people disengaging. Too many of them. Homelessness has driven. We've got it. My partner and I have an organisation called Backpacks for the Homeless. And we do it just out of our own, you know, money and stuff, but we hand them out, and I'm seeing increasing numbers. Over a large majority of them are Māori, a large majority of them have disabilities, many of them have mental health issues, drug, alcohol, but they are human beings, for goodness sake. Do you know that 2 women have killed themselves since the motel debts that have been landed to them with Wins? Did you know one in January killed herself over a $36,000 debt left to her by Wins? She couldn't cope, so she killed herself. This is what's happening to our people. You know, they said to us in the 1800s that we would be, that they were going to smooth the path of a dying race. We're in 2017, we're not dead. And I don't believe we will die. But I do believe we're damaged and we need to fix ourselves, and only us can do it. We need tino rangatiratanga back, and we need to claim it, and we need to claim it through rangamārie. We need to claim it through aroha. We need to claim it in a good way to show the example of what we can do. The thing is that Māori were the first to have a treaty signed with Indigenous peoples. We can be the first to show what it is to claim our sovereignty through a peaceful method rather than through violence. And we can lead by example. Kia ora whānau.